Okay. It's 7 o'clock. I'd like to call the Budget Review Committee to order. It's May 13th, 2020 at 7 p.m. and we're having this via teleconference. As chairman of the Budget Review Committee, I find that due to the state of emergency declared by the governor as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, and in accordance with the governor's emergency order number 12, pursuant to Executive Order 2020-04, this public body is authorized to meet electronically. Please note that there is no physical location to observe and listen contemporaneously this meeting, which was authorized pursuant to the governor's emergency order. However, in accordance with the emergency order, I am confirming that we are providing public access to the meeting by telephone with additional access possibilities by video or other electronic means. We are utilizing WebEx through the city's IT department for this electronic meeting. All members of the Budget Review Committee have the ability to communicate contemporaneously during this meeting through this platform, and the public has access to contemporaneously listen to this meeting through dialing the following number: 1-978-990-5298 and using the password 273-974. The public also may view this meeting on Comcast Channel 16. We've provided public notice the necessary information for accessing this meeting. We previously gave notice to the public of the necessary information for accessing this meeting through public postings. Instructions have also been provided on the City of Nashua's website at www.nashuanh.gov and publicly noticed at City Hall. We're also providing a mechanism for the public to alert the public body during the meeting if there are problems with access. If anyone has a problem accessing the meeting via phone or channel 16, please call 603-821-2049 and they will help you connect. Adjourning the meeting if the public is unable to access the meeting. In the event the public is unable to access the meeting via the methods mentioned above, the meeting will be adjourned and rescheduled. Please note that all votes that are taken during this meeting will be done by roll call. Let's start the meeting by taking a roll call attendance. When each member states their presence, please also state whether there is anyone in the room with you during the meeting, which is required under the right to know law. Alderman O'Brien, if you would call the roll, and please give the reasons for people not attending in person, confirm that they could hear the proceedings, and state who was with them.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Alderwoman at large, Shoshana Kelly.
I am here. I am alone. I can hear everyone, and I am attending remotely due to the governor's order.
Alderman Lodge, Michael O'Brien is present. I can hear the proceedings and I am alone. Alderman at Lodge, Laurie Wilshire.
I am here, I am alone, and I can hear the proceedings. I am staying at home due to the governor's orders.
Alderman Ernest Jetty.
I'm here, I can hear you. I am participating contemporaneously. At home due to the governor's order.
Alderman Jan Schmidt.
I am here. I can hear you, and the only person in this room is me. You may hear my bird, however.
Alderman at large, Ben Clement.
I am here. I am participating via telephone. There is no one in the room with me, and I'm participating this way due to the governor's executive order.
Chairman Alderman Richard Dowd.
I am here. I can hear everyone. I'm alone, and I'm alone doing electronically by a government order.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, there are 7 voting members of the Budget Review Committee present. Are there any other aldermen standing by that I did not call? Seeing none.
I'm not sure that Harry Gathright is here.
Okay, Linda Gathright, thank you. Alderwoman Lundegaard. All right, also in attendance is Sarah Marshall, Community Development Director. And I'm also going to go down the list. If I didn't get you, you speak out afterwards. I see Bill McKinney, Building Inspection, Nelson Ortega, Camille. I can't even read my own writing on your last name, Camille. Excuse me. What is it?
Patterson, P-A-T-T-I-S-O-N.
Thank you. Neil Patterson of Transport, Deb Chisholm, of Waterway Management. Is there any other director I did not call?
Perry, Urban Programs.
Urban Programs. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes. And your name, please?
Perry Skeena.
Thank you for that. Mr. Chairman, that conducts the roll call.
Okay, communications.
We have
Did you get Nelson Ortega, code enforcement?
Yes, I thought I did. Did I mention?
Yes, Nelson, yes. Did I mention you did.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for that. Mr. Chairman, we do have a communication from Cheryl Linda, Chief of Staff of the Mayor's Office. Reason, response to budget questions received from Alderman Clements. Also, Mr. Chairman, further communication from Lisa Foto, Director of Public Works. Reason, response to questions from Alderman Clements.
There being no objection, that I will accept the communication from the Mayor's Chief of Staff and Public Works Director and place them on file. Unfinished business?
There is none.
New business resolutions?
Before us this evening is R-20-17 relative to supplemental appropriation of $50,000 to fund a feasibility study for the future refuge, a reuse of the Elm Street Middle School building. Mr. Chairman, I would like to make a motion to recommend tabling by roll call.
The reason to table it is we have not had a public hearing on it as yet. Okay, would you call a roll?
Alderman Clements.
Yes.
Alderman Schmidt.
Yes.
Alderman Jetty.
Yes.
Alderman Elijah Wilshire.
Yes.
Alderman O'Brien votes yes. Alderwoman Kelly.
Yes.
Alderman Dowd.
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, that's 7 yeas, 0 nays.
Very good. R-20-017 is tabled. Okay. New business ordinances?
There is none.
We only have one item we're going to take from the table, Alderman O'Brien.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I would like to make, before us is R-20-023 relative to the adoption of fiscal year 2021 proposed budget for the City of Nashua General Enterprise and Special Revenue Funds. A public hearing is scheduled 5/20/2020 at 7 p.m. via WebEx. My motion will be to remove from the table by roll call.
Okay, call the roll.
Alderman Clements.
Yes.
Alderman Schmidt.
Yes.
Alderman Jetty.
Yes.
Alderman Wilshire.
Yes.
Alderman O'Brien votes yes. Alderwoman Kelly.
Yes.
Alderman Dowd.
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, is 7 yeas, 0 nays.
Okay, R-20-023 is now on the table, and this evening we're going to continue our department reviews, Community Development Division, Departments 153, 155, 170, 181, 182, 184, and 186. And on your agendas are the pages for the appropriations. Director Marshan, would you like to kick us off on your division?
Yes, please. Thank you so much for the introduction and the opportunity to speak with you tonight. I just wanted to quickly introduce the six departments and their leadership. Bill McKinney with Building Safety, Nelson Ortega, Code Enforcement, Deb Chisholm with Waterways and Hydroelectric, Harry Skeena, Urban Programs, Camille Pattison, Transportation, and Roger Houston did retire in January after a very long appreciated career with the City of Nashua. And we are very actively involved and almost complete with a new position, set who I hope to be able to introduce to you this summer. The pandemic has put a bit of a pause on bringing that person, new people on board, but we are very excited to be able to bring in a new head of the Planning and Zoning Department. As per the budget goes, the division came in under the mayor's mandated amount. And I just wanted to take the opportunity to actually say thank you to this amazing team I get to work with all the time, who has stepped up incredibly and in some cases changed entire operations in less than a week to be able to continue to provide high quality service during this pandemic. We've put a lot of new things in place, and hopefully these will sustain us and be even better, help us come back more resilient in the future. And it's just been great to work with people on such an important thing. And it's amazing how well functioning we all are remotely. And so I just want to say thank you.
Thank you. Do you want to start with building inspection?
Yes, please. Bill McKinney with Building and Safety.
Go ahead.
Yes, good evening. Yes, good evening, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to the committee for allowing us to speak this evening. I would direct you to page 209 of the budget for appropriations. There are no significant changes in our budget for this year. I do want to mention that we have a staff of 8 full-time employees for the Department of Building Safety. We did just recently bring on a replacement permit technician to bring our staff back up to that full 8, and she's working out exceptional for us and providing the customer service that we'd like. We've done some slight adjustments with our budget appropriations this year, but we have not raised appropriations other than the contract required salaries and benefits. And I would be glad to entertain any questions from the board.
Does anyone have any questions relative to Community Development's Building Inspection Department? Alderman Jetty.
Yes, my question is not about your not about the appropriation side, but the revenue side, the charges that you. Fees that you charge the building for building permits, electric permits, mechanical permits, plumbing permits, are they compatible or equal to what other places are charging? Is there any opportunity for additional revenue there to increase those fees at all?
3 years ago, we came before the Board of Aldermen at the time with a concern that our fees were significantly lower than several of the communities in our area, including some communities in Massachusetts and communities of common population, Manchester, Concord, King. So at that time, we had actually instituted a program of a biennial permit fee review. We are now in the midst of that review right now. This would be our 2-year term to bring fee proposals to the Board of Aldermen for increases, reductions, whichever that we feel are necessary. So this is the year that we would have that review completed. I anticipate that coming before the Board of Aldermen early to midsummer.
Okay, thank you.
You're very welcome.
Any other questions? Seeing none, we'll move on to Department 155, Code Enforcement, on page 213. Who's covering that?
Can you hear me now?
I can hear you now.
This is Nelson Ortega, Code Enforcement Manager. Good evening. And as far as my budget, which is on, like you mentioned, 213, we have had no changes. Everything, any kind of increase is to do with the payroll. But as far as all the other line items, everything is just up to par, equal to last year's.
Okay. Any questions relative to code enforcement?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Alderman Clements.
Yeah, so, and I'm not sure who, I'm not sure that Nelson might be able to answer this, but on the benefits line actually went down in the budget, and I'm just wondering why that is.
Sure. So there was a changeover in one of the code enforcement officers, and when there's a change in staff, they may elect a single plan, a two-person plan, or a family plan, and that would be why there was a change in the benefit.
Okay. Sounds good. I just wanted to make sure we didn't have a typo or anything like that.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Thanks.
All set, Alderman Clements?
Yes, thank you very much.
Any other questions on code enforcement? Seeing none, thank you, Nelson.
Thank you.
Next, we'll deal with Department 170, Waterways and Hydroelectric Operations, on page 216.
Good evening, this is Deb Chisholm, Waterways Manager. You'll see my budget is a little bit different than most. My whole department, all one of me, my labor is actually under Sarah's budget for community development. So what you're seeing in my budget is essentially the budget for hydroelectric operations for both Mine Falls and Jackson Mills. We have a slight increase. Most of that seems to be due to increases in dues and memberships and fees for things that we are required to be part of Granite State Hydro. And then we've got some other fees that have to be paid for the dams for both facilities. But otherwise, we're very similar to our expenses for last year. We also have a revenue line item that we keep the same. There's no real scientific or heavy math that goes into calculating what our estimate for revenue is, because it's very every year it changes. It's based on the efficiency of our equipment, which we're in the process of upgrading. It's based on rainfall and snowfall over the year that will increase or decrease the amount of flow that's going through both of the facilities, and also it will depend on the rate that we can get when we sell the electricity. So all three of those things play into the revenue. So
okay, thank you. Questions for hydroelectric operations? Alderman Jenny. Who else?
Shoshana Kelly.
Okay, Alderman Jetty and then Alderman Kelly.
So my question has to do with the hydroelectric power generation. Where do we stand with my memory is that we just that we're spending a lot of money replacing a turbine in the Jackson Falls hydroelectric plant.
So
where does that stand, and wouldn't that once that's online, wouldn't that generate more electricity? And but I see your budget for revenue is the same.
Right, we are very close to having a completed contract with the company that will be manufacturing the turbine and the controls and the generator for for Jackson Mills, hoping that that's going to actually go in next year. But you're right, we do have bond money that we're using for those expenses. The facility itself is kind of tiny, and we're currently exempt from a FERC license. If we were to change the capacity of the turbine at Jackson, we would have to go through a licensing process. So we are going to continue with a 1 megawatt turbine at Jackson, which is what we currently have. So while it might produce some efficiencies being new, we're going to try to get it as close as we can to generating as much power as we can without going over and then falling into the trap of having that FERC license. So the revenues will be similar, although at this point, it will take about a year to manufacture the turbine before it can get installed. We'll be probably installing it in the summer of next year.
So could I follow up? So there aren't two turbines there. I thought we were replacing one that wasn't working anymore.
So at Jackson, there is one turbine, and it's still, knock on wood, has been running great. That's the one that
we're losing your audio.
Okay.
Can you repeat that?
Okay. So we are, at this point, we are planning on replacing the Jackson turbine. It's the only one that we have in that facility. We have two turbines at Mine Falls, and one of them has just gone back online after being offline for a year. So our revenue at Mine Falls is about half of what it has been in the past because we've been replacing the parts of that turbine at Mine Falls.
Okay, so
go ahead, follow up.
So if we were at half capacity at Mine Falls, and we're going to double that, you know, shouldn't that be reflected in some increase in revenue?
Can I help here?
Sure.
So we budget the revenue based on a 10-year average of production. And so we use a 10-year trailing average because it is so variable. The biggest piece of this is really Mother Nature. You'll remember a couple summers ago, we had massive drought, and the drought lasted through the fall, and that is some of our biggest revenue producing time. So we use a 10-year trailing average to budget those revenues. And we haven't been fortunate enough to actually have a turbine down when we're budgeting. They seem to break outside of when we're trying to budget as well. So that's why it's generally about the same. And last year, it was such a wet, wonderful year. We went so far above and beyond revenues and projected, we actually had to make some surplus payment because we made so much money. So this year is not the case, but it's the same budget from year to year.
Okay, thank you.
All set, Alderman Jenny?
Yes, I am, thank you.
Yeah, because when you're dealing with Mother Nature, you gotta deal with averages because or highs and lows. Seems like we're having a lot of rain right now. Seems like the Penachuck ponds are very, very up. But, you know, if there's excess revenues, that's a good thing because that goes into the general fund, which would then offset taxes. So, all right, Alderman Kelly.
Thank you. Alderman Jetty stole my question, but I have a new one. I was going to ask the exact same question. So I actually want to ask about invasive species. Is that your disposal services 54221?
No, it is not. Okay. The invasive species does not get paid out of the hydro budget that you have in front of you. It comes out of community development.
Okay, I saw that there. And my question, and maybe I can wait for community development if that's the most appropriate time, was just how that's been going. With the shifts in temperature, we had snow in May. Are we seeing it being more of a problem and then potentially, you know, more of a strain on the budget?
Well, fortunately this year with invasive species from the aquatic side, we were actually pleasantly surprised that the state provided us with almost 40% of our funding for invasive species management this year. Last year it was closer to 20%. So we do, we have some expenses that we incur, and Nick Caggiano at Parks and Rec also provides some of the funding for our invasive species. This year we're treating the Nashua River north of the Mine Falls Dam, which we do every year. And then we are also treating the canal and the mill pond. And we're also treating Sandy Pond, so that that doesn't get too overgrown too quickly.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
All set, Alderman Kelly?
I am, thank you.
Any other questions for hydroelectric operations? I did notice that the operating and maintenance services is down. Is that because we are renovating that turbine and it's not going to be as expensive to maintain?
No, it's definitely not. It will, we've got some expenses that will be incurred during that time period. I'm hopeful that it might be a little less. They are out there frequently. At Jackson and at Mine Falls, tweaking things, because all of the equipment in both of those facilities is quite old. So the thought was that perhaps the labor would be a little bit less coming up. We were originally thinking that we were installing that turbine at Jackson this year instead of next year. So we'll see how that plays out.
Okay. Any other questions for hydroelectric? Thank you. Seeing none, we'll go on to Department 181, Community Development.
Good evening. Community Development has been stable. There are only changes based on the salaries and benefits. There are no other changes to this budget. And just to answer another question, under this budget in under other contracted services, that's where the invasive species is paid from. That is
okay. And you actually came in under the request of the mayor.
Correct.
Okay. And the total budget only increased $20,858 total. Okay. Any questions on community development? Seeing none. By the way, Alderman Jetty.
Yeah. So, what about the master plan? Does that come under your budget somewhere? Or?
Yes. Great question. It is under my budget. It's a separate fund. We are very close on selecting a firm. It's been pushed off a little bit with the pandemic, as so much energy and effort was put in another direction. But we're picking that ball back up and should have. I think the rest of the nominations to you for the master plan committee and a selection coming forward in short order for the consulting team we will be working with. So we are hopeful to get rocking and rolling over the next couple months with all the data background and looking to do the public outreach and engagement piece this fall. So that's the timeline.
So could I ask a follow-up?
Yeah.
So because of this this COVID-19 epidemic or pandemic, there's fear that our revenues are going to be down, that people aren't going to be able to pay their taxes, that we're going to get less of a share of rooms and meals tax, and the state is going to give us less money. So if that happens, if our income, if our revenue is short, would it make any sense to put off spending the money or on the master plan this year and maybe waiting a year to start that?
The funding has largely been appropriated for the first half of this to do the master plan. I also think this is an incredibly important time to have that conversation with our community this fall about where we're at, what we need, and how we want to look and grow. We're going to be approaching things differently going forward. And having a conversation that we haven't had in 20 years with our community about what they see the future of Nashua, how they want to see Nashua, and where they want to live, and what's most important, I think is incredibly important right now. And as these funds have been appropriated, it seems very timely and very appropriate to be able to make sure that our land use regulations and our planning and our long-term goals for the community can be laid out and articulated now, so we can put those policies in place to be the best city we can be going forward and being able to be more resilient coming back from that.
Alderman Jenny, all set? Or
if I could just follow up, you know, that makes a lot of sense to me. I just wonder, you know, when people are looking at a long range plan for the city and, you know, some of the great projects that we could undertake to make the city much better, you know, whether this current climate is going to make people feel less ambitious or less adventurous about planning for projects that might, you know, that they might see as costing more money than they can afford. So that was, but you know, I understand where you're coming from as well. Thank you.
Yeah, I'd just like to add that Director Marchand and I have had several conversations on this. This master plan is way overdue. This 2020 budget, we had put aside half the money and half the money in the 2021 budget. It's something that's going to save the city money in the long run. There are a number of things that are way, way out of date. And in order for us to proceed forward with any kind of a sensible plan and optimize the cities going forward, we need to do this master plan, and we need to do it sooner rather than later. I'm sure you'd agree, Director Marchand. Yes. Okay. Any other questions on community development? Seeing none. By the way, in my opinion alone, this is one area where we probably should have added more funds over the years, and how Director Marchand's keeping it level is amazing, to say the least. Also, in your budget, that's where the new person's going to reside?
It will actually be in the planning budget, which I think might be the next one.
Yeah. All right.
Yep. So and that's me too.
I looked at that earlier. Yes. Okay. So there are no other questions for community development? All right, next we'll go on to 182, planning and zoning, and that's on page 224.
Correct. Thank you so much.
I have my note about Roger.
Yes. this budget would include the new head of the planning department. Those are the main changes in this budget. The only other change is related to printing supplies. As we have the master plan coming up, we just wanted to have a line item in here for additional printing of materials. We also have some serious discussion about zoning changes in the next year, and those now require significant abutter notification. And so we beefed up some of those items that way. But otherwise, it's basically all benefit and salary changes.
Any questions on planning and zoning? Let me see if I had anything.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Alderman Jetty?
Yeah, my only question is, there's a picture on page 222,
yes.
The rendering of approved Temple Street apartment project. Where is that?
Yeah, it's a great question. that project is on the old, I think it was a Corvo Ruthier site. If you were on Temple Street, right, you drive past the Temple Street Diner, there's a railroad track. The very next huge open lot is this project. It was approved, I think, 176 units. It has a really nice architectural style. It has the potential for a mixed-use unit on that first floor corner. And it was very much done in mind with the future rail station at 25 Crown Street. And we are hopeful that it will be under construction probably next spring at this time, maybe earlier, maybe as soon as the fall, but that is not up to us. but there, it is actively on the market, and I've heard good things rumbling.
Alderman Jenny. Okay.
Thank you.
And that should add significant revenue to city's tax coffers. Mm-hmm. Any other questions on planning and zoning? Okay. Yeah, there's not too many. Oh, I had one question on dues and national regional planning. We had no expenses last year, but $66,110 this year.
Excellent question. That actually was a mistake last year. The dues from the National Regional Planning Commission have been the same for the past 5 years. This is the same exact amount. It was in the previous budgets, and it was unfortunately just left out of last year.
Did we have to pay someone out of something else?
We found the money, yes.
Okay.
Yes. Not necessarily in the division, but yeah.
Right. Any other questions? Seeing none.
I would just note that the last two departments are have large amounts of federal funding or are totally federally funded. And so urban programs and transit are a little bit different. Those budgets look different than the rest of the budgets in the city.
Yeah, the next department's 184, urban programs on page 228. Isn't that 100% funded by federal grants? The one question I have before we get into it is, when that federal grant money comes in, does it go into the general fund and then we draw down on it? Where does that money go into?
Hi, so I can take that. Carrie Skeena, Urban Programs Manager. As you said, the Urban Programs is fully funded through federal grants, primarily HUD, Housing and Urban Development. So we actually use those funds on a reimbursement basis. We find out what our allocation is going to be at some point in the year, and then we start a public process to allocate those funds out to do projects within the city, either through the city itself, community development, economic development, parks and rec, or out through the nonprofits in the community who are our partners. And then as we spend those funds, we draw them down from HUD, so they don't go into general fund.
Yes, I sort of knew the answer, but I wanted it to be stated so that anybody that wasn't aware of it would know how that money's offset against expenses versus revenue. So you want to add anything else relative to what's going on in the program or?
Sure. I mean, right now we have a lot going on. Typically on an annual basis, the department oversees those allocations. It's Community Development Block Grant or CDBG. The Home Improvement Partnership Program, which is all about affordable housing. We have a competitive lead paint grant, which right now is $2.4 million. That's actually nearing the end of that grant at the end of this calendar year. We're waiting to reapply. We think that NOFA will come out any day now, which will actually be a much larger grant. It's going to range anywhere from $4 to $5 million. For a new lead grant, so we hope to be able to do a lot more units and make a keep making a difference on that side. And then we also oversee the what we call the CAC process, which is the Citizens Advisory Commission. That does use some general fund that the mayor puts into the budget, and then it has a small portion of CDBG, and that is all for operating costs for nonprofits. So we coordinate that, and we take the applications, and then the commissioners review and make recommendations on those grants. CDBG and home actually goes through Human Affairs Committee, and that allocation process is done there.
Okay. Questions? Somebody have a question?
Yes, I do.
Alderman Jenny, then Alderman Wilshire.
So my question is, the money that the city pays to various nonprofit organizations in the city, does that all come from the CDBG, the federal money? I thought so, but you just said something about the mayor puts in some portion from the city funds. Does any of the city tax money go to nonprofits?
Yes, through the Citizens Advisory Commission. Those are the mayor recommends an amount. I believe they're under other human services, or Sarah can correct me if I'm wrong. It used to be run directly straight out of the mayor's office, and when Mayor Donches came in, it got folded into community development because of the link to CDBG. So this year, I want to say the amount out of general fund, and this is just for operating costs to nonprofits, was about $520,000, and the CDBG portion was like $96,000. In addition to the operating costs, separately, we also use the CDBG grant to do physical improvements, and that's the piece that goes through Human Affairs.
Okay, so if someone wanted to see which nonprofits are getting money from the city, where would they find one? Where would that be listed?
I meant to look up the page in the budget, Sarah. I don't know if you know offhand. I think it falls under the mayor's section.
It's under the budget. It's in the budget book in detail. I can't remember the page either offhand.
I'm sorry, I don't have the whole budget book in front of me. I could probably look it up as well, but it is also available on the Urban Program webpage. Every year, the awardees are in all of the application packets, and all of the backup is all, it's all on the Urban Program website.
Okay, thank you.
Alderman Wilshire?
Alderman Jetty, that's on page 63, the nonprofit. Okay.
Thank you.
I have a question about the 2020 consolidated plan. What's the status of that right now?
So one thing I didn't describe is that everything we do is based on a long-range plan. It's called the consolidated plan. It's a five-year period, which we're due to submit one right now. As you said, Alderman Wilshire, for 2020. So we had that process on track and then got obviously sidelined by the pandemic. So we put a pause on that in order to turn our attention to some other immediate needs. We are hoping to bring that back up and move it forward. There's legislation before Human Affairs Committee that's been tabled. So I'm hoping to get the draft consolidated plan out for public review around the beginning of June, and then allow a comment period. And we would bring that discussion back through Human Affairs Committee in the June timeline, and so that it can be approved by the Board of Aldermen near the end of June.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Just on your projected budget for urban programs, under 68 other expenses, there's $16,450 for relocation costs. What is that for?
Sure. So that's actually part of the lead paint grant. When we go in when the contractors go in to remediate the lead hazards, almost always the tenants need to temporarily
move
their units. So those are stipends that we offer the tenants while they're out.
Okay, I thought maybe you're getting a new office. No. I knew that was going to prompt questions in the public, so I thought I would point that out.
Sure.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, the next is Department 186, Transportation.
Hey,
Thank you. This is Camille for running Nashua Transit System. So we have a staff of 10 people that fall under the city, and then we contract with First Transit. First Transit hires the dispatchers and the drivers. Over the past year, we have continued to green our fleet, and we've replaced our trolleys with two new electric hybrid vehicles. And so all of our buses are either run on compressed natural gas or they're electric hybrid at this point, the full-size buses. And we're looking for an increase this year of $5,000. And if you look, as Sarah had mentioned earlier, we have a significant amount of our overall budget is paid for through either federal funds or state grants or contracts with other communities. So about 13% of our budget is actually from the city's general fund, and the rest comes from other sources.
Okay. Questions? Alderman O'Brien.
Thank you. I would like, Mr. Chairman, through the chair, to ask Ms. Patterson. I did go to the startup when we went to the hybrid buses. And if you could just mention to the public, as compared to what we would traditionally pay in diesel costs to run a typical bus, how much we are actually saving in fuel costs since we, you know, got those two buses. And I think that was a collaboration with BAE and everything, and it, it's just worked out perfect. The numbers to me were very surprising and positive.
Yeah, I don't have exact calculation on that. I could get it for you, but I can tell you that we definitely get significantly higher mileage in the electric hybrid buses than we do in the compressed natural gas, you know, in the order of 3 to 4 miles per gallon higher, which doesn't sound like a lot, but collectively over the course of a life or the year of a bus, it is significantly higher. I believe too, our biodiesel cost is actually cheaper right now than the compressed natural gas, actually significantly cheaper. So overall, it is a huge savings. And I know that the drivers really prefer driving the electric hybrids as well. So overall, it's been really successful. And a lot of people really did not enjoy the trolleys, and they have been pulled off the road and will just be used for special events. So that's kind of exciting.
All set, Alderman O'Brien.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, I was going to ask how those buses are doing since I have some interest in how they do. But I think that they're quite, were we ever thinking of adding any additional ones? Not trying to sell something. I'm just wondering if that's part of our replacements strategy.
Right, well, actually, really good position now that we actually have almost all of our entire fleet is in a state of good repair, which means that it's not exceeded its useful life. All of the fixed route is good. With the oldest vehicle we have is actually from 2013, I believe, 2014. That would be the next one to be replaced. But right now, we do not have plans or needs to replace any of the fixed route buses, the large buses. We do have two more vans that need to be replaced. They are beyond their useful life, and they'll be the next vehicles we replace. Although those ones, really, you can only buy them in gasoline. They do not manufacture them anymore in diesel, and the cost to do electric hybrid for those is prohibitive. We looked at that, and it just really doesn't make sense. It's almost twice the cost to get an electric hybrid for the smaller vans.
Okay. And when we replaced the vehicles in the transportation department, do we do that via SURF or do we use federal funds?
A combination. So they're listed in SURF. And what we typically do, we've been really successful lately. Basically, anytime a grant comes out that we can use for capital funds, we have applied for it. So that's actually how we got the electric hybrid buses. We apply for what's called a LONO grant, and it paid for those. And we did have the match from SURF. And then we also applied for a 5339 grant, and that's how we replaced the last remaining compressed natural gas bus that we brought online in the fall.
Okay, excellent. Alderman Jetty, did you have a question?
I do. So hopefully this coronavirus thing is not going to last forever. And I know that when you plan your plans are long range, not short range. But do you people in the transportation business, I'm sure you talk to people all over the country, You know, what are you thinking about? How are you going to be able to maintain these large buses? If people have to keep 6 or more feet apart, how are they going to be able to? How are you going to be able to do that in an enclosed space like a bus?
That's a great question. So we've been thinking about this and having a lot of discussions about this. So we have gone through the vehicles and figured out that we can socially distance safely 9 people on a large bus, the 35 footer, 6 or 7 people on a 30 foot bus. We can get 4 people safely on the vans right now. And our maintenance crew is looking at installing barriers at the front of the bus to try to create an additional barrier and protection between the driver and the passengers. This sounds kind of funny, but a lot of places are actually doing a very simple solution with just using shower curtains, which we think will be effective in the vans. Very inexpensive, easy to replace, really hard to find right now. So we're grappling with that. Our Gili buses, they actually have manufactured kits that you can put like a plexiglass barrier at the front of the bus. It still allows the driver to be able to see and engage with the passenger, but have an added level of protection. And our guys have actually been looking at how they can manufacture something themselves. So they're mocking up a model that they think they can then go to a plexiglass place and see what they can do to figure something out. They're very good and they're talented at being able to manufacture something. And each bus is a little bit different and it has to attach in different ways. So we're looking at that and also, making signs on the buses so that people know where they can sit, making sure there's enough space between the driver where those seats will stay vacant to try to increase everyone's safety. And we've been sanitizing, everything, deep clean every night.
All set, Alderman Jenny?
If I just have a follow-up. So will that, I don't know whether, I'm assuming that the fares that people pay are a small portion of your budget. And I'm assuming that this is having an effect on that. How do you anticipate being able to continue with a drop in fare revenue?
That's a great question. And I think that's a drop in fare revenue that will be sustained for quite some time. There's going to be a certain level of uneasiness and people just in behaving in their previous manners are not going to be the same going forward. We did receive a significant amount of funding from the CARES Act, and that is intended to offset your loss that you would have from farebox revenue or advertising revenue. And that's intended to sustain you for a while into the future. So we've been working with finance on that and figuring out what is the best way to maximize those funds. One of the nice things about that too is they're not requiring a local match. So it makes your dollars, it's easier to access those funds going forward. So I think this year it's gonna be much different, but I do think that we were very successful in getting funding to help us get through this and be successful on the other side. And it's also allowing us to try out some other models. We've essentially been providing on-demand van service more like a Lyft or Uber, which we've wanted to test out for a while, and it's allowing us to test that out. And I do think on the other side of this, that's kind of more where we're going to be going. We'll be trying to look at some more innovative services. It's really what people want ultimately. And this allows us to try it out. So in a way, there's a bit of a golden piece to it that we're trying to maximize.
All set, okay. Alderman Jenny?
Yes, thank you.
Alderman Lopez, you're either cleaning your screen or wanted a question.
Yes to both. by the way, I've been here since 7:30. I was just lurking. I just wanted to suggest, in terms of creating barriers, it might be a good idea to talk to Make It Labs. They've been doing a lot of laser cutting of plastic materials, so you might be able to come up with a cost-effective alternative that's generated locally rather than shipped away or whatever.
It's a great idea. The
kind of project they get excited about. So.
Thanks.
All set, Alderman Lopez?
Lopez.
Any other questions?
Yes.
Go ahead. You're all set. All right. Any other questions? I have a couple. We just signed the contract, the Board of Aldermen, or we didn't sign the contract, but we gave authority for the contract to service Hudson, Merrimack, a couple other places. When do you anticipate starting that service, and will that obviously, if things were better, it'd be different, but improve your revenues to some degree.
So we've been partnering with those communities for years. I don't know the exact length. I'm going to say about 10 years. So it's just basically a continuation of that service. We are still right now providing service to residents, you know, who are in Hudson, Merrimack, or coming to Nashua. And SVTC might have been the other one that you were thinking of, that's Greater Milford. So they do have a downturn in ridership right now, just as everybody does. But I do expect that that will, you know, pick up slowly. And again, if we run into challenges with that, that's what the CARES Act funding is for.
So the other question is, Hudson's looking at possible, unfortunately, they're getting taking Green Meadow Golf Course, but they're talking about putting in a major logistics hub and 2,500 new employees. I would like to believe some of them will live in Nashua and need to get there. I don't know if that will improve ridership, but is that possibility? I think you go down, you go all the way down to BAE in Hudson.
No, we don't do the route in Hudson. We do the demand response, but that might be an opportunity to see if they're willing to partner with us and maybe extend a service line into Hudson.
Okay, sounds good. The other thing is, I don't know if you've considered it, but we just approved a grant to the police department for electric static cleaning machines for their vehicles and their, and actually their building, the larger one. Is that something that either you do use now or are thinking of using to clean buses?
So we don't use that now. It's definitely something that we should probably look into and just see if there's merit to doing that rather than what we're doing now. Right now, we're using a combination of just basic sanitization or wipes on all the touch surfaces. We spray everything down with Lysol, and we also bought a fogger that disinfects, so we can spray that throughout the larger vehicles. It's more time effective and cost effective because you go through a lot of Lysol on a big bus. And that seems to be, the foggers seem to be the standard in the transit industry that we're seeing a lot of other agencies use right now.
Any chance of getting federal funds to pay for those? Or?
Yep, that, I mean, that's what the CARES Act is there. It allows you to use it for, you know, PPE, for additional cleaning supplies, additional costs with starting service back up or reducing service. So yes, all of those would fall under that funding option.
Yeah, the reason you may not be able to find the shower curtains, today I saw on Facebook that grandparents are making shower curtains with arms so you can hug your grandchild safely.
That could be part of the problem.
Very innovative. Any other questions for transportation?
I don't think that would really work.
Okay. Are there any other questions at all for community development?
Alderman Dowd.
Yes, Director Marchand.
Sorry, I do have one correction. Thanks to CFO Griffin. The NRPC dues were previously in the civic and community activities area of the budget last year, and that's where that money was paid out of, but the amount has not changed.
Okay, so the more important thing is the overall budget stays the same based on the fact that the amount's the same and it was just covered somewhere else in the budget last year.
Correct.
For anybody that thinks it's going from zero to 66,000.
Yes.
Any other questions? Thank you all for being with us tonight and giving us the insight into the community development budget. Hopefully everyone stays safe. We're going to be having a public hearing on the budget on a week from today at 7 o'clock via WebEx. We'll be looking forward to running through all of the divisions at that time. All right. Thank you very much, Director Marchand, and you and your staff. Okay. All right. Alderman O'Brien. You're on mute. You're still on mute.
Yep. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For our transcriber, if I may, I would like to say that Alderman Lopez has joined the budget hearing at 7:30. Mr. Chairman, I would like to make a motion to adjourn by roll call.
You missed one. You have to table the budget.
Oh, yes, excuse me. I would withdraw my motion and to make a...
We also have a couple other things.
Please bear with me. Kind of in a rush to get out of it. I'm sorry. No, I'm not. Mr. Chairman, I would like to make a motion to table R20-023 relative to the adoption of fiscal year 2021 proposed budget for the City of Nashua General Enterprise and Special Revenue Funds. There will be a public hearing 5/20/2020 at 7 p.m. via WebEx. And may I have this roll call confirmation by roll call.
Good.
Thank you. Alderman Clemens?
Yeah.
Alderman Schmidt?
Yes.
Alderman Jetty?
Yes.
Alderman Wilshire?
Yes.
Alderman O'Brien votes yea. Alderman Kelly?
Yes.
Alderman Dowd?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, 7 yeas, 0 nays.
All right, motion carried, and budget discussion is tabled until next Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, when we will be going over the educational budget. General discussion. Does anybody have anything they would like to discuss? Nope. Remarks by Alderman? Seeing none, we don't have a need for a non-public motion. All right, now you can do your motion, Alderman Brian.
Mr. Chairman, thank you so much. I've been waiting for this. Again, to the transcribers, I'd like to note that Alderman Lopez did join us at 7:30 this evening. Mr. Chairman, I would like to make a motion to adjourn by roll call.
Okay.
Alderman Clemens.
Yes.
Alderman Schmidt?
Yes.
Alderman Jetty?
Yes.
Alderman Wilshire?
Yes. Yes.
Alderman O'Brien votes yea. Alderwoman Kelly?
Yes.
And Alderman Dowd?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, that's 7 yeas, 0 nays.
Motion carried. We're adjourned at 8:02 p.m. Thank you.